Hey guys, my wife and I wore continuous glucose monitors and tried five of the worst foods for your blood sugar levels. We then tried the same foods again, this time with common blood glucose hacks like apple cider vinegar and walking. Here's how we got on. So I went online and I found a list of 10 of the worst foods for blood glucose. From there, we selected five. Those were breakfast cereal, instant oatmeal, sushi, pizza, and grapes. We then repeated each meal with something that is said to reduce the blood glucose spike. I should point out that even though we are both non-diabetics, deliberately spiking your blood sugar is not healthy, and we both felt the negative effects on energy levels, focus, and hunger during this experiment. We measured the results in two ways. Firstly, the peak value, so the highest that our glucose reached, and secondly, something that's called the AUC, area under the curve, which measures the overall rise in glucose. And that's measured from a 2-hour window starting from the first bite of food. The order we ate the foods was randomized and it tended to be for either breakfast or lunch. We also remained seated for at least 90 minutes after the meal to keep it somewhat controlled. There were certainly other factors that may have influenced each result. So let's go through the results one meal at a time, starting with cereal. For context, it's generally best to keep under 7.8 millimoles per litre, 140 in American units. And also, research has shown that two people can eat exactly the same food and have a completely different glucose response. For cereal, we opted for Cheerios and semi-skimmed milk, quite a decent portion. I peaked at 7.2, my wife went up to 8.7, but came down very quickly, meaning my AUC was actually higher. Adding in half a teaspoon of cinnamon, said to help curb your blood sugar, actually made mine worse, rising to 8.2. My wife hit 9.0 with over twice the AUC of the first bowl. Next up, instant oatmeal. So the manufacturers are basically taking regular oatmeal and shredding it to reduce cooking time, but that also means your body doesn't have to work as hard to bring it into your bloodstream. So that should result in a higher peak value. This was my wife's highest peak of all meals at 10.7 millimoles per litre, which is 192 milligrams per deciliter, but this wasn't her biggest AUC. Switching to thick steel-cut oats, unfortunately, had no real effect for me, while for my wife, it was much improved. Third on the list was sushi, and I really enjoyed this one. We bought a high-quality pack of maki and nigiri, and it had some lethal wasabi. My blood glucose was less pleased. This was my highest peak and my wife's highest AUC. The second test meal was immediately followed by a 15-minute brisk walk, and this was the only glucose hack where we both saw improvements. After that, it was pizza. I wasn't sure if it had to be deep dish because a higher fat to carbohydrate ratio tends to do okay for glucose, so I went for a thin crust pepperoni, which is around 750 calories. Neither of us saw anything dramatic, and actually a diluted serving of apple cider vinegar just before it made both of us score worse with the retest. Since fasted glucose tends to jump around a bit, I was using the same base value of 5.0 to calculate every area under the curve. And this is probably a meal that shows why that's not the best method. That leaves grapes, 250 grams, which is half a punnet, slightly worse than pizza, but not as dramatic as what we've seen. Eating at least 4 grams of fat for every 10 grams of carbohydrate was shown in the research to blunt the glucose peak. The relative rise in glucose was much lower for my retest and the same for my wife. In an ideal world, we'd test each meal multiple times and control for all other variables like recent exercise or how well we slept. And it's possible that that would have given us results that were closer to expectations. I've used apple cider vinegar before with a lot of success, so it just goes to show you how much other factors could have influenced that and how you can't really trust a single measurement. That being said, I've also found that a 15-minute walk was the most effective thing for me, and that was the only one to bring us both in the right direction. I have an idea why some of my results are odd. I had a whole 48-hour period where my glucose was going a bit mad, maybe from plying it with so much sushi and plain oatmeal. So the apple cider vinegar test and the grapes and cheese didn't really stand a chance. My wife has the added difficulty of having a variable glucose response depending on where she is in her cycle. The hormone progesterone is responsible for higher spikes, and so any tests during the luteal phase are less reliable. Just to reiterate, spiking your glucose is really not a game. It's something we felt the negative effects of even after just doing it for 2 weeks on both energy levels and focus. We were both getting hungrier far sooner after the meals that spiked our glucose, and we were having trouble concentrating at work. While your goal isn't necessarily a perfect straight line, if you are seeing very large spikes, then it's worth either modifying the meal or introducing some of the hacks like the 15-minute walk after eating. If you want to learn more about glucose and insulin resistance, please check out my other videos on the topic. Also, be aware that it's estimated up to 1 million people in the UK and 6 million people in the US are living with undiagnosed diabetes. If you think that might be you, I'd recommend getting a blood test for HbA1c. The results indicate your average blood glucose levels over the last 90 days, and it can help diagnose any issues. Thanks for watching.